Yes, sir.
No, you can do it for any order reaction, but the thing is again that since in this question is clearly given first order, you have to find out, correct? That you need to prove. But suppose they, if they ask you the order of the reaction, then you have to assume one by one, okay, zero order, first order, and then second order. That you can do. Obviously, if you assume zero order, then you have to take the expression of K for zero order reaction. Are you getting it?
Yes, sir.
But the value of K for two set of data will be equal only when your assumption is correct.
Yes, sir.
Right. So mostly for zero and one, you will get the, you know, answer. And second thing, or suppose if you get this question in the exam, they are asking you the order of the reaction in competitive exam, then we know in zero order, equal amount will react, correct? Means in equal time interval, 240 second, suppose if equal time interval is given, then equal amount must react. If that is not there, it means zero order is not possible. I'm not talking about this question. In general, I'm talking about, suppose zero to 220, 240, then again 480. If it is 480 here, then this, the amount that reacts over here, equal amount should react here in equal time interval, if it is zero order. Yes?
Yes, sir, yes.
If it is first order, then what we'll do? Percentage that reacts must be same. So we'll find out the percentage which reacts over here.
Okay. Clear?
So in that way also you can do, obviously this kind of question, if they ask in competitive exam, they want you to, you know, waste your time because it will, you know, just a hunch you are using over here. Okay, zero order and then one order and all. This kind of question, I would say if it is very calculative, if you're not getting it quickly, then leave it for the last. Like if you have last 10, 15 minutes left, then you can try this kind of question. Don't waste time on this. Anyways, so we'll move on. So next, see all these things, if you recall the last class, we were talking about the factors affecting rate of reaction. Yes or no? We have discussed the nature of reactant and product. We have discussed concentration and all these things, order and everything that we have discussed, RLE and all, it is under the concentration factor, correct? So let's go back and just revise quickly that we were talking about the factors affecting rate of reaction. And in the concentration factor, we have discussed this much of thing, which is mostly, you know, half of your chapter, correct? Now the next factor is, that is temperature, and the next one is catalyst. These two factors we need to discuss, but before going into temperature, we'll discuss one small concept, that is molecularity. It's a theoretical thing. We'll finish this and then we'll move on to the temperature, the other factor here. So heading you write down, molecularity. In board exam and in competitive exam, they ask questions about this, with this molecularity and order. In board, they many times they have asked this, write down the difference between order and molecularity. Okay, very common thing. It is given in NCERT also. Okay, write down molecularity. It is equals to equal to the number of molecules, the number of reactant molecules, write down, number of reactant molecules involved in dimension, you can use Venkat if K value is given, no? K ka unit is not given over there, correct?
Oh, what I thought, sir, we could take one, we could find out K respectively and then do it. But then since we're equating K, We're just taking different values and finding out K so that they're equal. Okay, sir, got it.
Different orders actually. That you can do if K value is given with unit, then you can understand, okay, this is the order of the reaction. But here the k value is not given. You don't know what value of k you are going to get.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Right. Plus the unit also. If unit is given, you can do that easily. Number of reactant molecules involved in the balanced reaction. Involved in the balanced reaction. Point was write down. It is the theoretical concept. Theoretical concept. And if in complex reaction, we check the number of molecules, reactant molecules. When I say molecules here, reactant molecules present in the slowest step. So we just have to see one single step, right? So if you have complex reaction, so molecularity we define with respect to the slowest step, if multiple steps are there. So hence we also say it is defined for elementary reaction, means one single step, elementary reaction. That also we say. Okay. It must be a whole number because it is a sum of the molecules. So it cannot be zero, negative or fraction. Correct. So it must be a whole number. Or must be an integer, not whole. Must be. Zero is not possible. So we can have 1, 2, 3 here. But order, if you see, order can be anything. It can be zero, it can be negative, it can be positive, it can be fractional. But it is always either 1, 2, 3 and like that. Write down reaction with molecularity. Greater equal to 4. Some book it is written 3 also over here. Both are rare only. 3 and 4 molecularities are rare. 3 to some extent is fine, but 4 is also very rare. Reaction with molecularity greater equal to 4 is very rare. It is independent of pressure and temperature. Pressure and temperature. So these are the few things, few points for molecularity that you must memorize. Difference between order and it is independent of pressure and temperature. Order depends upon pressure and temperature. That's also we have one point. Done. Okay. Next, the next factor which affects the rate of the reaction we have, write down factor number 4 is temperature. See, temperature has a significant effect on the rate of a reaction. Because if you increase the temperature, then the molecules' energy, right? Overall, the average energy, if you see for the molecules, that also increase. Hence, kinetic energy increase. Kinetic energy increase, so we can have more collision, which we can say that collision frequency increases. When collision frequency increases, then rate of the reaction also increases. Correct? So write down this. Write down, temperature has a great influence on the reaction rate. Temperature has a great influence on the reaction rate. On the reaction rate. In general, as temperature increases, rate of the reaction also increases. Next line. It has been observed that for every 10 degree rise in temperature, the rate constant becomes doubled. Rate constant I'm talking about, you see, it's not rate of the reaction. Okay. However, both are related in a similar way. Means if rate constant increases, rate of the reaction also increases. But it is rate constant which gets doubled. No, here it is not. We'll talk about endo and exo. Temperature won't affect the rate. In general, whatever the, you know, the nature of the reaction, endo or exo, with increase in temperature, the rate always increases.
But isn't that a bit contradictory?
Why?
For exothermic reaction, if you want to produce, if you give more energy, won't it like reduce the rate of reaction or something?
No, it's not. Because we are talking about, first of all, you are confused with equilibrium constant, rate constant.
Right? Oh, okay.
So you are talking about reversible reaction. Okay.
Okay,
and I'm talking about, we have A and B and conversion of A and B into product. So when you increase temperature, the collision frequency of A and B increases. There will be more collision per unit time. And hence, the conversion of into product will be more. Rate of reaction will be more.
Oh, okay, sir. Got it, sir.
I'll come to your point. I understood what you are thinking. I'll come to that point. Give me some time.
Sure, okay? sir.
So this is the thing, right? So temperature is... in general, what you have to keep in mind, temperature increases, rate of the reaction increases. Why it happens? Because rate constant increases, K increases. Okay. And the relation of rate constant, one more thing I forgot. Okay. I said for every 10 degree rise in temperature, the rate constant becomes doubled, right? So if you see, if you take the ratio of rate constant K at a temperature T plus 10, divided by K at temperature T. So obviously we have 10 degree rise in temperature here. So this ratio, we call it as mu. And this mu is temperature coefficient, important. Temperature coefficient, okay? And this is observed to be nearly equals to 2. In some book, they have written becomes doubled or tripled. This also they have written in the book. But for solving question, you take this two only. Okay, the temperature coefficient for every 10 degree rise becomes double. ठीक है, is it fine?
Sir, how is it the same for every reaction?
Same as in what?
So like it doubles for every reaction if you change the temperature by 10 degrees.
It depends. That's what I said. It has been observed. It's an experimental thing. Because it depends upon the collision frequency plus the energy barrier. Okay. So whatever the nature of the, obviously it is not true for all the reactions. It is there for some of the reactions. For few reactions, it becomes tripled also. So if it is two or three possible, it is also possible that it could be any other number. But mostly it becomes almost doubled, not exactly equals to, almost doubled. That is the experimental observation we have. For our syllabus, for our question that you get related to this, you have to take the ratio as two only. You won't get any other value over here. Or you can say in other way that the reaction that they give here in this chapter in our syllabus, for those reactions, the ratio for every 10 degree rise is coming out to be two. Both ways you can understand.
Okay.
Why it becomes doubled or tripled? That there are two to three factors, collision frequency plus energy barrier. Also, we have over there, which can overcome easily. Okay, we'll talk about that energy barrier after some time. Okay, so this is what we observed overall. We discussed overall that what happens overall if you increase the temperature, correct? But the relation of rate constant with temperature is given by a scientist called, Swedish scientist called Arrhenius. Okay, it is observed by a Dutch chemist called Wenthoff that, okay, rise in temperature. Rate of the reaction increases, rate constant increases, and rate of the reaction increases. It is initially observed by Wenthoff, the Dutch chemist, and the relation of K and T, rate constant temperature, is given by Arrhenius. Okay, so right now the relation of rate constant and temperature is given by Arrhenius, and this equation, which relates rate constant K and temperature, is called Arrhenius equation. It is equals to A e to the power minus E A by R T. This is Arrhenius equation. Okay, K is the rate constant. All the terms you write down. K is the rate constant. We know already. A is, we call this A as frequency factor. Frequency factor. We also call it as pre-exponential factor. Pre-exponential factor. Or we have one more name here, that is Arrhenius factor. EA is activation energy, R is the gas constant. EA is activation energy. R is the gas constant, universal gas constant, T is the temperature. Done. Clear? Copy? Okay. Now you see, if K1 and K2 are the rate constant at T1 and T2 temperature respectively. Okay, then can we write this ln K1 is equals to ln A minus EA by RT1? Yes. Equation 1. Okay. ln K2 is equals to again ln A minus EA by RT2. This is equation 2. If you subtract 1 minus 2, the expression you will get ln K1 by K2 is equals to EA by R 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1. This is the expression we have. I memorize this expression like this. Since I have started with 1 by T2 here, so here also I will place K2. T2, so K2 here. Okay. ln, if you convert in log, so I will write on log of K2 by K1, I will write on here. And once I write K2 by K1, this side will have a negative sign, EA. 2.303 R 1 by T2 minus 1 by T1. So here if I start with K2, here also I'll start with T2. Here if you start with K1, then with a negative sign outside, here also you can start with T1. Okay. So this is how I memorize this expression. Remember the similar kind of expression we have discussed in chemical equilibrium also, yes?
Van't Hoff equation
we call it as, if you remember that. Right? Yes, tell me. This equation is mostly there for irreversible reactions. In chemical equilibrium chapter, if you go back and recall, instead of this EA, we'll have delta H over there. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Right. This is very important because now that you know, because we are doing chemical kinetics, so you definitely know this fact that this K1 and K2 are the rate constant. But if you do not, you know, focus on the difference in the two reaction, right? Then in the exam, if you get this expression, you'll get confused that whether this K is rate constant or equilibrium constant. Yes. So how do you differentiate the two? If here delta H is written, it means the expression is given for reversible reaction. And then with delta H, this K1 and K2 are the equilibrium constant at two different temperatures. It is not the rate constant. It's clear? Write down this in your notes, okay? In your own word. If delta H is written over here, it means these are the equilibrium constant. If EA is written, activation energy, then K1 and K2 are the rate constant. It is not equilibrium constant. And then expression is valid for irreversible reaction. Clear?
Could you please repeat?
I said, if here delta H is written, it means K1 and K2 are the equilibrium constant. If EA is written, then this K1 and K2 are the rate constant, and this relation is for irreversible reaction. Okay. You look at this relation. I'll write down this side also. Relation is ln k is equals to ln a minus ea by rt at any temperature t. So first of all, this a and ea are collectively called activation energy and Arrhenius factor. These two terms collectively called Arrhenius parameter. Arrhenius parameter. If you draw a graph over here, graph of log k, rate constant, and 1 by t on the x-axis. The graph would be a straight line like this with a negative slope. And what is the slope over here? Tell me the slope.
Ea by r.
Minus ea by r, right? Minus ea by r, where r is the rate constant. But this is not correct. Why this is not correct? Because I have taken log k, it's not ln k. And this is a mistake you made in the test also. Slope is this. Because this is log k, it's not ln k. Yes.
Yes.
Correct. So keep this in mind. These things you don't have to memorize. I would say that just keep that Arrhenius equation in mind. K is equals to A e to the power minus EA by RT. From there, you can derive everything. If you try to mug it up, then this kind of mistake possible in the exam. Okay. So this is the temperature dependent relation we have. Okay. Now in this also, like, no. Few questions they ask, very basic and easy questions. I'll show you one question. I'll show you. They'll give you this kind of expression and they'll ask you to find out once again. Yeah. Based on the same relation, Arrhenius equation, you can get two, three types of questions. only one relation. The only thing is a bit calculation will be there in these kind of questions, but it is very straightforward. You see this one? Option A you are getting. I think D is the correct. Are you getting D, anyone? Oh yeah, D. Okay, just you need to equate and you need to solve this. Okay, nothing much, just the calculation we have here. K1 is equals to K2, you equate and then you take log and solve this. Yeah, so for K1 is equals to K2, we'll have 10 to the power 15 e to the power minus 2000 by t is equals to, oh, wait, into this equals to 10 to the power 14 e to the power minus 1000 by t. Okay, so when you cancel this out and take ln both side, so you will have ln 10 is equals to 1000 by t. 1000 by t, okay. So which is equals to 2.303 log 10. So t is equals to, we'll get 1000 by 2.303. So 400 something, 434.2 Kelvin we get. Okay, sometimes another type of question is what they'll give you the expression of this log k is equals to some value, they will give minus some value into 1 by t like this. Okay, so they'll ask you to find out the activation energy here. So this term is nothing but Ea by 2.303 R. So whatever term we have here, you equate this Ea by 2.303 R, you'll get the answer. So this kind of very basic questions you'll get. Okay, you won't get any, you won't have any difficulty in this. This is the temperature factor we have, okay, for affecting the rate of a reaction. It affects the rate constant and then the rate of the reaction. Now the last part here, the last term or the factor which affects the rate of the reaction is the catalyst. Okay. What is catalyst? Catalyst is the element or substance which changes the rate of the reaction. It changes the rate of reaction without taking part in it. We know catalyst does not take part in the reaction. Okay, it just affects the rate of the reaction. It can enhance the rate or it can reduce the rate also. Both ways possible. That depends upon the nature of the catalyst. So we have two types of catalyst. The first one is positive catalyst and the second one is negative catalyst. Positive catalyst negative catalyst. Positive catalyst, write down. It increases the rate of the reaction. It increases the rate of the reaction by decreasing the activation energy. Okay, so it increases the rate of the reaction by decreasing activation energy. Okay, so basically in presence of positive catalyst, what happens? Activation energy decreases. If you have a reversible reaction, I'm taking an example of it. A reversible reaction, if you have, then the positive catalyst will enhance the rate of forward as well as backward reaction. Right, so it increases RF, rate of forward reaction, and RB, rate of backward reaction. Both it will enhance. And hence it will achieve the equilibrium sooner. That is the reason, use of positive catalyst we have. Suppose we have N2 plus H2 gives NH3. Reversible reaction. If you want to increase the production of ammonia, then we use the positive catalyst so that the, ignore this one. Because it does not affect the amount of product and reactant. No, I was thinking something else. Anyways, so if you want to achieve the equilibrium sooner, you can add some positive catalyst. So it's not like it will always affect the forward reaction. If reaction is reversible, so both way, the rate of the reaction increases by decreasing the activation energy. So purpose of catalyst or the effect of catalyst is what? It decreases activation energy, positive catalyst, and increases the rate of the reaction. If you have negative catalyst, so it is exactly opposite. Negative catalyst increases the activation energy. Activation energy increases. And when activation energy increases, the rate of the reaction decreases. ROR decreases. Whether it is forward or backward, ROR decreases. Done. If you look at the graph here, this y-axis is the potential energy. Energy or potential energy. And this x-axis is the collision frequency, you can say. Or collision number, we can say, or we can also say progress of reaction. X-axis. So we have a graph. Okay, we have certain energy of the reactant. It will go to a maxima and then wait. Suppose it's the reaction we have. I am assuming exothermic. Anything it could be. Exothermic, endothermic, anything it could be. Here it is exothermic. This is reactant. And this is the product. So this much amount of energy releases. Okay. Now, if the reaction is taking place in presence of a catalyst, it may go like this. Goes to a maxima. Initial and final stage will be same in terms of energy. Okay. And if you have one more catalyst, it may go like this. So here you see this energy here. This energy is the activation energy. Okay. Okay. So this graph, the orange one that I have written here, this graph is with negative catalyst. This one. Negative catalyst. And this green one is for positive catalyst. And the white one, there is no catalyst present here for this one. Without catalyst. So this distance that you have here from this point to this point, this is the activation energy of the reaction, this distance. Right. This point, we call it as activated complex. Okay. The reactant molecule collides, it forms an activated complex, which has the maximum energy, and then it converts into the product. Okay. So this is the activation energy of the reaction. This energy here, you see, this difference that we have here, this difference, right? It is the activation energy in presence of positive catalyst, because the activation energy, the positive catalyst, decreases the activation energy. And if this gap is less, the energy gap between the reactant molecule and the activated complex is less, then the particles can easily overcome this. And hence the rate of the reaction increases. This is for positive catalyst. Activation energy for positive catalyst decreases activation energy. And this, the white one that you have, is for activation energy, is for negative catalyst. So it increases the activation energy so that if the energy barrier is more, then it is difficult for these particles, the reactant particles, to overcome this energy barrier and forms the product. Hence, the rate of the reaction decreases here. Understood?
So I don't understand what the x-axis is.
Sorry?
So the x-axis.
X-axis is collision number, means you can say it's collision frequency, nothing much. When the two molecules collide, so per unit time, if more number of molecules collides, so collision frequency is more. Or simply, if you are getting confused, you can also consider this as progress of reaction. This is nothing but the energy. So reactant converts into product. Time you can write, or progress of reaction also you can write. Same thing. Few more things we need to understand in this graph. Terms we have, energy terms, that is threshold energy and all. We'll discuss that in collision theory. So we'll come to this graph again. Before going into the collision theory, we'll discuss reaction mechanism. Okay. What is reaction mechanism? How do we draw the graph? And with graph, what all things we can conclude? Okay, did you copy this, all of you? Okay.